Hello, welcome to worship with Bridgewater Church of the Brethren on Sunday, August 23rd. It's now Thursday, and I'm sitting here on the front portico of the church building and enjoying a beautiful Thursday afternoon as we prepare for worship. We continue to be very grateful for all of you that are sending in contributions through our electronic giving and by mail. It keeps things running smoothly and allows us to honor our commitments that we've made to others and to our staff and to our programs, and we're just very grateful for that continuing. We're also grateful for all of you that have been contributing to the Open Doors project that Josh spoke about last week in the children's time. We have a collection bin right here on the portico. It's bright red. You can't miss it. And I think we already have some underpants and some deodorants and other items to donate for Open Doors and the ministry that they have. And so please do continue to bring those contributions in. You can just come up anytime and drop them here right in this bin, and we'll be collecting those for Open Doors. Bridgewater Church of the Brethren is an inclusive family of faith seeking to follow Jesus and live the love of God. You can always find out more about us by visiting our website at bwcob.org. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us. And this Sunday, we are very glad to welcome Kyle Remnant, who will be sharing some of his thoughts and reflections. And I actually see Kyle coming now.
Well, hey, Chris, what are you doing in my dad's chair?
Just enjoying a beautiful Thursday afternoon.
Oh, it's a gorgeous day.
It is a gorgeous day.
Yeah. It's all right. Dad's in Texas anyway, visiting the grandson, so he won't fight you for it.
Excellent. So I'll enjoy it in the meantime.
Oh, absolutely. Great chairs. So, worship this week.
Yeah. What do you got for us?
What do I have planned, or what do I have brewing?
Good question.
I always have thoughts stirring, but plans aren't my thing. But I'll tell you what I've missed this summer.
Okay.
Let me start with that. What I have missed this summer, you know, it's been a tough year. Summer, you usually get out to enjoy many, many things. This summer, I've missed two things especially. And that's Vacation Bible School here at the church. And something not church-related is Marvel films.
Oh.
You know, the movie industry had to shut down right now, too, so they've delayed a lot of releases for theaters. Black Widow was supposed to come out in May,
yes.
And it may or may not come out in November. So we'll see.
We'll see.
So I've missed those two things, and I'm thinking, you know, if there was a way to combine my enjoyment of Vacation Bible School and the church's ministry of Vacation Bible School, and, you know, get my, like, childish comic book side out, like, that I would really enjoy to somehow combine those two things.
Yeah. Well, you know, we did that a couple years ago at Vacation Bible School. Superhero theme? I think it was, just 4 years ago or so.
Yeah. It's almost as long as college.
For some.
Yeah.
For some, yeah.
Oh, 4 years. Well, yeah, okay, yeah. Palmer was Super Duper Man.
Super Duper Man, yeah.
And then he had his sidekicks.
Yes.
Ben and Jasmine.
Yeah.
A younger version of Ben. Maybe we'll have to pull that out of the vault. That's on video, is it not?
On video. Mm. We do have it in the vault. I'll see what I can do.
I think that would be a great way to enter us into maybe an unusual worship service today.
Yeah. Well, if we can, do that, I think that would be a great way to explore some of those things you've been missing.
Is there like a conch shell or something we need to blow to find Super Duper Man?
I don't know. Maybe some time travel?
Ooh. Time travel, to just get back 4 years ago, like a pin particle.
Pin particles.
All right. Let's see if it works.
Indeed.
Greetings to all you superheroes out there. I am Super Duper Man, and today I'll be taking in two new sidekicks. Sidekick boy, sidekick girl. They should be here any minute now. Ah, that's them. They're using the secret door knock code. I should push this button to let them in.
Bzzz.
Come on in.
Hello, Super Duper Man. We came as soon as we could. Do you know how hard it is to change in a phone booth?
Yeah, especially since there's two of us.
Well, I'm surprised you found a phone booth at all. I think you should try to find a larger place to change in.
Golly gee, Super Duper Man, you're right. We should find somewhere else to robe up.
And hopefully something larger this time.
Well, you can worry about that problem later. Right now, I have an assignment for you.
All right. What do you want us to do? Catch some bad guys? Save a life?
Give a dog a flea and tick bath?
No, not exactly. I want you two to take a test.
Who's buried in Grant's tomb? How much wood could a woodchuck chuck? If a woodchuck could chuck wood?
What's the best thing to put into a pie? What kind of test is this?
The test I want you two to take. I want you to be over there and take it. And come back when you're done.
Okay, I'll give it my best.
This is crazy, but I'll do it.
This is going to take a while. You hearers out there, I want you all to listen to this in the meantime.
What does the Lord require of you? Heroes are always listening for God to call them into action. And heroes are ready to answer the call because they know that God will always be with them when they follow where God leads.
All right, Super Duper Man. I finished this test to the best of my abilities. How'd I do?
I knew that the best thing to put into a pie was your teeth, but I wasn't sure about the other answers.
You two did great.
But you threw the test away. You couldn't have seen what answers I put down.
What answers you put down was not part of the test. Your willingness to take the test was the test itself.
I'm confused.
Well, allow me to explain. To be a hero, the first thing you must do is answer the call. Then after you answer the call, you must be willing to do whatever it takes to fulfill what you was called for. Even if you don't understand the reason why you need to do it. It didn't make sense for you to take a test that featured questions that sounded odd. But you did take that test and fulfill what I called you to do. That is the first step of being a superhero. To answer a call and fulfill the need, whatever it takes.
I think I get it now. We have to answer the call, no matter how odd or out of place it sounds, and it'll all become clear in the end.
So the answers we put on the test didn't matter. Our willingness to take the test in the first place is what counted.
Super! You two are one step closer to being a superhero. Uh-oh, it's getting late. You better hurry on home so your parents don't get worried. I'll see you here tomorrow.
Uh-huh, and whenever I hear the call, I shall answer it.
Watch out, world. A superhero is coming at you.
Ah, good, good, good. And for all you superheroes out there, I think you have things to do. As for me, I have to save planet Earth from invaders from space. Goodbye!
We all have our own unique stories, our own upbringings and journeys, our own struggles and celebrations. We all experience a life that no one else will. Yet, we choose to share the journey, to walk the mile and share the load, because grieving alone is unbearable, and because celebrating by ourselves is just no fun. So we do life together, as a community of faith. We join together for worship, connecting from different places, committed to writing the ongoing story of God's love among us and continuing the work of Jesus, peacefully, simply, and together.
Shadow of time. here I am back at the beach. Still my painting. I'm actually at my house. I had my first full week of school this week with no kids yet, but it was kind of crazy being back doing something normalish. It was a lot of work and I had a lot of frustrations, but I was glad to see my work friends. And so overall, I think it was pretty good. Still got a lot of work to do. So I wonder what's going on in your life. I wish you would tell me, or could tell me, I mean. Today I wanted to talk about heroes. But before we get into that discussion, I want to play a game. I want to play a game of guess the hero. All right, I'm going to describe a hero and I want you to guess who it is. Okay, so first one. He is from outer space, dark black hair. He wears a blue suit with an S on the chest, and he can fly. Sometimes he goes by the Man of Steel. That's right, that was Superman. All right, ready for another one? She is the most powerful person in all of the Marvel universe. She can fly, and she actually lives in outer space and keeps the whole Marvel galaxy safe. Do you know that one? Yep. She's Captain Marvel, right? All right. How about this one? He can climb walls. He also wears a blue suit. He can shoot webs. And he protects the good people from the bad people using his webs. Right? That one was Spider-Man. All right, a little bit different. This man actually led a lot of marches, freedom marches, and marches for civil rights in the 60s. He was very famous. He gave a very famous speech called I Have a Dream. Right, Martin Luther King Jr., also a hero. One more. She, back before the Civil War, worked as a conductor on the Underground Railroad. And I've read that she took could have been over 800 slaves on the Underground Railroad to freedom in the North. Every day, risking her life, she came back and would get new slaves and took, like I said, I read up to 800 people to freedom in the North. Do you know who that is? Might be the upper elementary kids for this one. Remember? Harriet Tubman. Very good. Now, here's actually a couple more. This one, he comes by my house on Tuesday and Friday, drives a great big truck, and he picks up my garbage. The garbage man, that's right. Last one. She actually walks through my neighborhood every day, except for Sunday. Oh, no, they actually come Sunday too. She wears a satchel, and she puts letters in my mailbox. That's right, the mail lady, the mail woman. Now, you might be sitting there thinking, how are Superman, Captain Marvel, Spider-Man, Martin Luther King Jr., Harriet Tubman, the trash man and the mail lady, how are they heroes? How are they all in the same category? But to me, they are, because they all did things to help other people, or they do things to help other people. Superman saves the world. Martin Luther King worked for change for an entire race of people. But even the trash man, he does something for people to help. It's a very little thing. But can you imagine if your garbage wasn't collected each week? How stinky and gross our houses would be? Or if the mail lady didn't bring us letters so we could, you know, keep up with our friends and get birthday cards or get packages in the mail? Those are little things, but they make a big difference. And that's what I really think heroes do. A lot of the heroes in our lives do very little things, like possibly donating deodorant and underpants to help people at Open Doors. but they make a huge difference to people. Can you think of a time where someone's done something little for you, but it made a big difference? Have you ever been in the line at the grocery store or going through a drive-thru somewhere where they're like, let me pay for the person behind me? That's the kind of thing. Are those people heroes? Maybe, because they did a little thing, but it made a big difference in somebody's life. And then the last heroes I want to talk about. We've been home, away from each other at church for months and months and months now, but there have been people that have had to go, their lives really didn't change all that much because they had to keep working. People like nurses and people at the grocery store, because we didn't stop having to eat and we didn't stop getting sick. But so they had to keep working. And to me, that kept those people as heroes. And I mean, you can't even say that nurses do a little thing. They do big things. But to me, it's important to remember it's not just the Superman and the famous people in our history books that are the heroes. It's you and me and our grandmas and grandpas and moms and dads. It's the people who do little things, but those little things make a big difference. And you know what? I think our church, and especially the kids, are really good at doing the little things to make a big difference. And that means that you guys are all heroes. And I'm happy to know you as a hero. Will you say a prayer for me? Prayer with me before we go? Dear God, thank you for all the heroes and the little things they do that make a big difference. Amen. The art challenge is still up. I didn't have any new artwork this week. I'd love to put your artwork behind me. So keep that in mind. I hope you all have a great week. See you soon, I hope.
Is not always easy. What do I say? How do I say it? Who should I be praying for? Is it selfish for me to ask God for whatever? I think we often overthink it. We put undue pressure on ourselves that every prayer has to be polished and perfect. And I don't think that that's what God expects. Prayer is a practice, not a performance. And we don't often know how to pray as we should. So this morning, we'll simplify the prayer using three words: thanks, sorry, and please. The Spirit will intercede for us in sighs too deep for words. Let us enter this time of prayer, placing our hopes and fears into the loving hands of our God.
Good
please pray with me. Thanks, God, for the opportunity to worship together in the midst of a pandemic. Thanks, God, for the supportive community of faith at the Bridgewater Church of the Brethren. Thanks, God, for your grace and love shown to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thanks, God, for the unsung heroes in our lives who show us how to live more like you. Sorry, God, for the times we have prioritized our own selfishness over your vision for the world. Sorry, God, when we fall short of our calling to love one another, when we select words that tear down instead of ones that build up. Sorry, God, for the times we judge others more critically than we judge ourselves, and for the times when judgments prevent us from deeper relationships with you and with others. Please, God, grant us the courage to be a presence of your peace in our community and in our turbulent world. Please, God, keep us safe and healthy from the ills that surround us. Please, God, comfort those who live in the midst of political and social unrest in Belarus, in Mali, in the United States. Please, God, protect those who have been evacuated and lost homes due to natural and other disasters, from flooding in China, from fires in Northern California and Brazil, from the derecho in the Midwest, from the explosion in Beirut. Please, God, guide our local and national leaders as they discern the best decisions for opening our schools, and keep our students, teachers, and parents healthy and patient as we navigate educational paths for this school year. Please, God, comfort us in our grief, guide us on our journey, and grant us wisdom and courage to face the days to come. Amen.
David was the youngest of Jesse's 12 sons. One day, the nation of Israel was called to fight the Philistine army that had gathered for war. While David's brothers went to fight, young David stayed back. The two armies gathered to stand on opposite sides of a deep valley. A great Philistine giant named Goliath, that stood over 9 feet tall, came to the front of the Philistine battle each day for 40 days and mocked the Israelites and their God. Goliath called to them to fight, but King Saul and the Israelites were scared and did nothing. David was sent by his dad Jesse to visit the front lines and bring back the battle news for his brothers. David heard Goliath mocking Israel and their God. David was brave and volunteered to fight Goliath. He persuaded King Saul to let him go fight and decided not to wear any of King Saul's armor. David carried his sling and gathered 5 smooth stones. Goliath laughed at David, but David responded that even though Goliath had a sword and a spear, he came in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel. David put a rock in his sling and swung one of the rocks at Goliath's head. The rock sank into the giant's forehead and fell. David then picked up Goliath's sword and used it to kill Goliath and cut off his head. The Philistines turned and ran when they saw their giant hero killed. Israel had won the battle because of a boy who had faith and trust in God.
I want to start out by talking about something that is rarely talked about in the church: comic books. I was never all that into them as a kid. I'd maybe read some of my friends' collections, but never bought any comic books of my own. When Marvel started releasing the films that collectively now make up the Marvel Cinematic Universe, I never understood what the buzz was all about. Superheroes beating each other up, not exactly my cup of pacifist tea. Then the COVID-19 quarantine happened, and I made use of our Disney Plus account to watch all the available Marvel films in chronological order. I am now hooked. Each character has a compelling story.
from origin to struggle to triumph. It's even more exciting when multiple heroes' journeys overlap and their stories are shared. Since April, I've seen most of the films twice and found an appreciation for the comic book genre, reading over 100 comic books in the same time span. Yes, it still includes an abundance of superheroes beating each other up, but I've come to appreciate the underlying values of many of the story arcs. X-Men isn't just about mutant wars. It's about civil rights. Black Panther isn't just about tribal wars. It's about civil rights and race relations. Captain America isn't just a piece of patriotic propaganda. He is symbolic of the fight against fascism. Deadpool, a mercenary known as the Merc with the Mouth, is pansexual, a fact that wasn't made public until 2013. Fabian Nicieza, the creator of Deadpool, had the following to say about fans' need to define the character's sexuality. And I quote, "It is a bit tiring. He is no sex and all sexes. He is yours and everyone else's. So, not dismissive, but rather the epitome of inclusive." End quote. Art reflects culture. It always has. So it is no surprise that Marvel tackles these and other difficult topics through the narrative arc of the hero's journey. And I, for one, appreciate the inclusivity with which they tell their stories. I've somewhat modeled this morning's message is after a typical story arc of a comic book in three issues, which I've called this morning Origins, Struggles, and Triumphs, each one separated by some additional hero reflections by Brent Hall. So first, the origin story. Every main comic book character gets one, including Black Widow, whose origin story film has been postponed a few times now, thanks to COVID-19. The origin story gives us insight into the character's upbringing, their background, how they received their powers or skills. Which leads us to the origin story of our hero, David. David was a musician and a shepherd, the youngest of 12 sons. Certainly one of the most unassuming heroes in the Bible. He goes to the battlefront to get some news from his brothers and realizes everyone is crippled with fear because of Goliath. Goliath, the almost 10-foot Philistine villain that mocked the Israelites who were too afraid to test him. David, a scrawny musician, runt of the litter, is the one who summons the bravery to face the fear no one else will. He persuades King Saul to let him fight, but refuses to use the armor. Maybe he's too small for it. Maybe it's too heavy for him. Or maybe he just doesn't need it. Working smarter, not harder, David picks the sling and 5 stones as his weapon of choice. He'd only need one for Goliath, because David also has the God of Israel on his side. According to the biblical account, David's first and only shot sinks into Goliath's forehead and knocks him down, dead. Then there's a beheading part, which seems entirely unnecessary. But this is the origin story of David, one of the most revered men in our Bible. We know it well. We've heard this story over and over as the coming-of-age story of the eventual King David. But how do we receive it? Do we receive it with joy that David murdered Goliath, the evil Philistine giant? Do we receive it with horror in that the hero of our story became the villain in someone else's? Or do we write it off as just another messy Old Testament story? If God also created Goliath, why would God choose sides? There are so many more questions I have for this story I so confidently accepted as a child. I've struggled a lot with this story recently, and the rest of David's life, really, but we'll get into David's later mistakes in the next issue. I will say, in David's defense, he didn't exactly have an Uncle Ben to tell him with great power comes great responsibility. Alas, one of our most heralded religious forefathers got his claim to fame from murder. This should not sit well with those of us with pacifistic roots, but it is David's coming-of-age story. It is a story that can teach us that underdogs can win, and overcoming long odds is possible. But it is a story that is only told from one perspective, that of the winning team. In the next issue, will David die a hero or live long enough to become the villain? Stay tuned.
Moses, Moses, rest your head. You got a big job, the great God said. Moses, Moses, gather your strength to lead my people through the wilderness. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. Hebrews, Hebrews, rest your heads. You'll be leaving soon, old Moses said. Hebrews, Hebrews, gather your strength. You soon have to travel through the wilderness. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. Moses, Moses, take your people and flee. Take them on down to the great Red Sea. Moses, Moses, hold your rod up high. You take them through the water, high and dry. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. Moses, Moses, stand up tall. Your people need food, I can hear them call. Moses trusted God so well. Sweet, sweet manna from the sky it fell. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. Hebrews, Hebrews, what went wrong? You built an idol and sang its song. Hebrews, Hebrews, tear it down. I am the great God, it's his holy ground. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. Moses, Moses, take my law, give it to my people so they don't fall. Moses, Moses, better be brave, I am the great God our people to save. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. Take them through the valleys, take them through the mountains, take them many miles that you just can't count them. Take them through the sea, take them through the sand, take them to the shore of the promised land. You know the song is over, but the story never ends.
So, David is a hero. News of his victory over Goliath spreads quickly, and David becomes quite the popular fella. King Saul, initially impressed with David, soon grows envious of him and plots his death. Here begin the struggles for our hero. David flees and seeks shelter in Nob, then in Gath, then Adullam, then Moab, but not for long, then the forest of Hereth, then to Keilah, which means citadel, then eventually to the wilderness of Ziph. David is on the run for quite some time, avoiding Saul. Eventually, reconciliation is reached, and Saul recognizes David as his successor. Saul and his son Jonathan, who loved David, sadly die in battle. David becomes king of Israel and then wages war against just about everybody. Then he sees and lusts after a woman, Bathsheba, wife of Uriah the Hittite. But David can't hold tight and summons her at night. He knows that it's not right because she's wed to the Hittite. Things get right wild when she bears his child, and David has Uriah killed. Then David marries the widow Bathsheba, and nowhere are her feelings mentioned. I care not to speculate on her feelings in this moment, but David's actions are rightly called out by the prophet Nathan, and God punishes David through the death of the child to whom Bathsheba gave life. That's where I'll leave the whirlwind narrative of David's struggles, though there are more struggles in the full story. To me, David is like one of the many comic book characters that could be a hero in one issue and a villain in the next. Equal parts character flaws and redeeming qualities, like he'll kill your husband and then turn around and write your favorite psalm. Always an enigma, that David. But what can we take away from the struggles of David's journey? I doubt many of us can resonate with the specifics of David's story. But the emotional roller coaster of life? Yeah, maybe that sounds familiar. And maybe the most important thing about David is that he's human. Not a superhero with fictitious powers. David, like each of us, is prone to selfishness. Each of us, like David, is capable of greatness. It's often a day-to-day, minute-by-minute struggle to determine which one we'll choose. This year has been difficult. I struggle to articulate how difficult, as I'm sure many of you do as well. The Spirit will intercede in sighs too deep for words, we are told. In addition to everything going on in the world, our church family has experienced an extra dose of grief. And instead of forcing out words that won't come to me yet, I want to share this story from a friend and former youth director here at the Bridgewater Church of the Brethren, Jessica Crawford. Jessica's grandmother, Lafayette Richardson, passed away in 2018 at the beautiful age of 101. She shared the following with me about her hero this week. She was an incredible woman who leaned into the power of the Serenity Prayer to get her through the toughest times in her life. She raised 5 great kids and conquered a battle with alcoholism through faith. She left a legacy of love in her 11 grandchildren and 17 great-grandchildren. I truly believe that when I make music, I'm living out a gift she gave me. She is my hero because of the way she unconditionally loved and supported her family and the way she faced life's biggest challenges with faith. She lived her life by the motto, "God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change what I can, and the wisdom to know the difference." She showed me that living well means having faith and loving others deeply. Jessica wrote the song Serenity for her grandmother, and she recorded it in her grandmother's house, which was in the family for 125 years until it sold last month. Let us pause in the midst of the struggle to search for serenity.
We Tell me what's your story of the road that you've traveled, of the shadows and the battles that shook you to the core. We're all broken vessels, just hoping to be useful, but somehow in our weakness we find something more. 'Cause the
2020 is not the first wilderness experience for the body of believers. After Moses led the Israelites out of Egypt, they spent many years struggling in the wilderness. Jeremiah wrote a letter to the exiles in Babylon, who were stuck for 70 years away from their homeland, and he told them to seek the peace of the city to which you have been called. We heard about David's journey through wilderness after wilderness after self-imposed wilderness. Jesus spent 40 days being tempted in the wilderness, and he turned out all right. I guess what I'm saying is we're not alone in the struggle. That doesn't make it easy, doesn't make the anxiety go away, doesn't ease our concerns about jobs and schools and politics and equality and our health. But it does offer some hope that we're not alone. The heroes we often look up to are those who come out of difficult situations stronger than before. But those heroes need someone in their corner too. You know, in the comics, every so often there is a threat so menacing that it takes a team of superheroes to overcome. The beautiful thing about the church is that team is already built in, because we choose to share the journey, to walk the mile, to share the load, because grieving alone is unbearable. So we do life together through all the struggle. In the next issue, what then are we to say about these things? Tell me something good. To be concluded.
He rode straight in the saddle, about 5'9" tall. Not a great big man, but a friend to all. With his big black hat and his Bible in his hand, he went north and south in this war-torn land. John. He sat atop a fine black mare, took that horse most everywhere. Near 30,000 miles is what I've heard, visiting the sick and preaching the word. Little John. John Klein. John Klein was a farmer, lived right around here. On a farm in Broadway, he made it clear that he loved Anna Wampler, who became his wife. Together they built a pretty fine life. John. John Klein was a writer and a preacher too. He learned about medicine and what to do when folks got sick. Little John. John Klein. He preached at funerals and started new congregations, planted new churches, spreading the word. He was against the war and wrote letters to say, "We are the brethren, we don't think that way." John. John loved all men, no matter their size. It hurt his heart when any soldier died. But there were some folks who couldn't understand why. So they started saying, "John Klein's a spy." John. John. John Klein. There were some people who hated John Klein. They wanted him to die before his time. They waited one day with a gun and a knife, and when John Klein rode by, they took his life. John. John fell from a saddle like a mighty oak. He hit the ground mid fire and smoke. For miles around, it was understood that the man who died was mighty good. John. John. John Klein. Now the story of John Klein spread far and wide. It's not for nothing that the little man died. We're singing this song so you can understand that little John Klein was a great big man. John. John Klein. John.
In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those He justified, He also glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised for life, is at the right hand of God and also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword, as it is written? For your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height or depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
All right, let's finish this story arc and get right to the joy. It's Morphin time, and what better way to present some joy than the Power Rangers theme song, sung exuberantly by some of our church's youngest heroes.
Go, go, Power Ranger! Don't you ever stop! Go, go, Power Ranger! You will rise up to the top! Rangers forever! You'll always together!
If that doesn't amp you up to take on whatever challenges you face this week, I'm not sure what will. But perhaps maybe the word of God will help too. If God is for us, then who can be against us? I'm going to say it. Bold take. Unpopular opinion. I don't like this verse. I think it ruins us. It implies that God takes sides in earthly matters, like David beating Goliath because God chose sides. I think God is on the side of life and love. And I think God loves all God has brought to life. But some interpretations of this verse open us up to an us versus them mentality that really just separates us from those we view as others. If we all claim God is on our side, we must realize we are all on the same team. We're all on the same side, as broken as we may be. God doesn't pick sides. God is just with us. Emmanuel, God with us, God with all of us. Because when you're stuck in a pandemic, when you're up against circumstances you've never seen before, and when life seems as complicated and difficult as ever, the only way out is together. We are more than conquerors. Conquerors, like superheroes, just beat each other up a lot. And we don't need more of that in today's world. But heroes, the everyday unsung heroes who pursue justice, who serve others in loving kindness, and do it all under the radar, that's what we need more of. What does the Lord require but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God? That's being a hero. No matter the circumstances, the heights or depths, present or future, regardless of any powers or anything else in all of creation, nothing separates us from the love of God. And as much as we try to separate ourselves from others based on grudges or perceived differences, the love of God is still within us and between us and among us. Nothing will ever change that. God is for all of us, and if God is for all of us, that's news worth celebrating. But celebrating alone is no fun. So share the love of God, friends. That's what heroes do. Like David, we each have the power to face and overcome our greatest challenges, and then turn right around and fall victim to our most sinful impulses. We are broken. We are beautiful. We are human. We fall short of the glory of God, yet reap the rewards of grace. Sure, sometimes we mess up and become the villain. Sometimes circumstances make us the victim. But when we answer the call to serve a neighbor in need, we get the chance to become a hero in someone else's story. But more importantly, we answer the call to further God's kingdom here on earth. May it be so.
In the With God as our source of strength, we may find the courage to make a positive impact on our community, because you never know when someone might need a friendly neighborhood hero.